I am. Gotta talk about your hometown a little bit. Not really my hometown, but Speyer am Rhein, Heidelberg, Ludwigshafen, Mannheim, Frankfurt, south of Frankfurt, Germany.
Yes.
This little piece is 2,000 years old. Was named by the Romans as a fort. This is a large Roman Catholic cathedral, one of the largest ones besides St. Peter in Europe. Yeah? And you can see there's all this medieval structures and winding of the roads. Yeah? Basically, brick sandstone buildings with wooden roofing and then shingles. Yeah? Pottery, clay based. Yeah? Large road, and this is actually a tower, the old gate tower. So actually the city wall goes this way, somewhat. Yeah? And then here railroad comes in as an age of transition, technology change. Yeah? But the idea, technology. Yeah, that's a church. Now, part of Lynch, talking about urban design, if you do this, this is not the loser sign. This is a professional urban design scale. If you look on the street and you look up the houses, this is a classic, does this make sense, thumb rule. Yeah? If you're with an urban designer on a field trip, urban designer will always take a look like this. Does this make sense? Because then if you look at this, how wide that streetscape is versus the height of the building. Yeah, that's about half, one, two, three, 3.5 floors. Yeah? Everyone, take a look at it. If you don't make it, next time you're on the street, do it. Again, this is not the loser sign. Right? I know. Yeah?
Well, in the brickle, that model doesn't work.
Just to give you an idea, this building was founded in something like 1140. So that's history. Yeah? I burned it down a few times, but it's impressive. Just across the river, you can see here, largest river, the Rhine. Yeah? Just across the river, the city of Mannheim. And I encourage you guys, you can Google this. Classic defensive structure, citadel, bomb ball system. Yeah, with medieval ages, with cannon powder, gunpowder and cannons, they build these walls, but they are actually facing like this, so you can actually shoot at different angles. Mm. You're not just facing it like this, but you shoot can create actually crossfires. Very interesting from the military conquest. But they also did squares, as a city here, fortified around it. This is 1606, yeah? And this is the elite. A few years later, different times in Europe. No wars anymore. We're talking about the times of enlightenment. French Revolution is coming, but the whole idea of now the exchange of thoughts, philosophy starts, yeah. So diplomacy starts. People are not going to battle anymore, not really. But the idea was, let's change this pattern, extend the quarters, and put actually, instead of a fortified castle, more a renaissance, like a fun place. Yeah? So instead of a bunker, it's now the White House, yeah? Something like that. But again, see that the old structure is still there. Context is still there. Even if this is a few hundred years ago, different continent. Lessons learned from that is respect and see if you can deal with structure and context. Huh? This is about last 30 years. Now I actually have a railroad coming in here. Sorry, here, railroad. Huh? That's a rail station. That's still the castle, they modified it, that's the University of Mannheim now. And they changed the whole setup here with even the interstate coming in straight into downtown and a green belt, a ring street around it. The interesting thing is that like like in Washington DC, ABCs and 1, 2, 1, 2, 3s, depending on the direction. Mm-hmm. So you literally live in quadrant A125. Yeah? That's your address. That's the area of photography about a few years ago. Yeah? Castle or university now, main rail station, that is the point here. Yeah? And you can nicely overlap and see how infrastructure and old structures now are merged. Yeah?
So does the Autobahn end there? Does it end right there? The Autobahn?
Yeah, that's a connector coming in. That's a connector coming in. This is a connector, a feed. This is Ludwigshafen. And down here is the main Autobahn, actually Bundesstraße in that area. Okay. So they feed different ones in together. Yeah? Very complex because of the up here. Is one of the largest chemical industries in Germany, BASF, chemical agricultural chemistry. So there's a huge supply system around it by rail and by street. Yeah. But again, the historic persistence of the structures are there, hasn't changed over hundreds of years. Yeah. All right, quick trip to Italy. We're going to go here to a place called Udine, if I remember right. You can see this fortification system here. Now it's a more green space. And like how they did the star system and maintained that over the years. Yeah? That's part of their culture. But I say, this is us. This is historical medieval town called Rothenburg ob der Tauber. So whenever you do the tourist trip to Germany for historic towns, they brand themselves that they're the most historic town in Germany, with also a complete restored city walls, and they are so down the street with their zoning regulations that when McDonald's wanted to go inside the historic core, they couldn't put up the golden arches. They actually went to a blacksmith and had them made out of metal, so you actually can see the metal M. 15 or 20, 20 years that I was there last time, but you actually have the McDonald's, but the facade is in that medieval signage context. Mm. Land use regulations and ordinances, it doesn't have to be your enemy, you just have to deal with it, communicate. Mm. Yeah? Who has been to Turin? Torino? Italy? I got screwed up. Here's the old citadel, fortification, the compartments. A little bit here, fun place, hunting, etc. You can see this here as well, apartments, the citadel completely is gone. Might have changed the slides. But you can see how this still fits. If you look very carefully, the pattern in this area changes. It's disrupted with plazas. Huh? Very, very carefully. But an example of historic towns bringing in, another German example, when it comes to shopping center planning, this is a very crazy example. This is actually a castle, a residence castle, with a specific point here. It's the geometric target point, like a centroid. But the idea was to build this whole thing for hunting with certain magnet functions. What's your strategic visual perspective? Now remember, the Lynch book talks about perspective. Are you on top of the hill or just at the brow of the hill? Depending on what you want to develop, hill top might not be the best way if you want to sell landscape view. You might just develop just on the bottom of it. Yeah? Same thing here, they actually built this castle with the specific points, how His Majesty or the person in place, the greatness is spreading out, but also the hunting, those facets, and they still have that as of today, but they also put a football or soccer club field in here, soccer stadium. Yeah? Historic preservation means develop. What's next? Some ideas, some impressions. I find this fitting, this is actually Inception in Lego. Yeah? What is the vision? Now it's the time to wake up.
Lights?
Yeah, what's the vision? What's your idea after seeing all this? Reading Lynch, what's your own idea of a vision. Mana.
Oh, dream.
Start dream. So the most famous, really bad in this, the most famous vision is I have a dream. Mm-hmm. Yeah?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What's the vision for a community? What's the vision for you? What's the vision for your family? How would you define in a scientific way? How would you define vision? If you have to tell Marinella in three sentences, in one sentence, what is the vision? How would you do that?
Where you want to be tomorrow?
Because it's like I'm predisposed already, so my vision is I can't visualize from a blank slate what a vision of a trees. I don't know, like it's just Jane.
Go ahead, guys.
It's a futuristic transformation of a current plan. No,
let him speak, let him speak. Respectful communication, let him speak.
Yeah.
A futuristic transformation of a plan or a layout to meet certain goals and objectives.
Almost. You're talking about implementation of the vision, but you're in the right way. It's an idea. Okay. Anything else? Charlene.
Okay, so a vision can be what you want something to be portrayed as, depending on what that area needs, depending on what the people need, or just whatever you see that can adapt.
Right, like he says all the time, like this. Right. Well, you're laughing about him. This is a dictionary. Vision as something seen in a dream, trance, or ecstasy. Oh, you might have heard that before. Something you have seen in a dream, trance, or ecstasy. That doesn't mean that you're completely wrong if you have a dream or a vision about how things should be or how you want to have things done. Huh? It's very important. This is dreams. This is not disillusional pipe dream. No? This is, what's your idea? If I would ask, let's assume this would be an undergraduate class, sophomore year, so I'm pretty sure on the age profile. And I would ask you, what's your idea, what's your dream when you're 30? I don't know, I don't even know what to do next Saturday. Huh? Well, if I ask you, what's your idea, what's your vision after you're done with this program, I would expect her to have an idea that will form and transform over time, because this is your first day of classes, versus you guys counting down seven sessions, yeah, getting it done with a good grade. Yeah? But we had this discussion about expectations. You're in the program a year, a little bit more than a year. You had different expectations. Sometimes they have been met. Sometimes they collided with reality. But sometimes your program went beyond expectations. But your vision, I'm doing this education because I have certain ideas, what I want to do, might have changed or transformed. For sure, it has not failed you, and the program has not failed you. Otherwise, you would have said, hey, I'm gone. No? However, the important part when we come from the planning world and personal ideas, again, felt values, social identity, culture, how do you brainstorm, abstract that term vision? Because then, depending on what's your vision, it turns into your mission statement. Turns into your implementation, your operationalization, meaning a livable city as a vision means in terms of public works, infrastructure, landscaping, this and that. Yeah? This is how you translate it into implementation. that, if you cross-reference this with our readings, it also means this is this hen and egg problem we're just talking about. Do you have a vision, an objective to develop this land before you step on the land? Or do you create this vision and how to develop that land the moment you're on it? This example of the meditation and the spirits, yeah, versus best bang for the buck, cookie cutter setting. Yeah? Reduce the backyard, make it feasible as you cut the lawn within 10 minutes, unless you provide homeowner association fees for maintenance. Yeah?
Yes. Could that be a combination of both? You can have an idea of what you want to build, but it kind of alters or it changes once you get on the site. Because what you want to build in your vision and what's on the site might not work together. So you have to.
So you deal with conflict?
Conflict. Alter your vision. Or, you know,
constraints and limitations.
I don't know if it's one or the other. I think it's a working.
I guess you always start with a vision regardless of what it is. And it's like you ended doing something totally different of what you might thought it would be because of the restriction. But you always, I guess, start with a vision, and then by the time that you get into it, start changing. But that vision is always there, kind of like what you want to see. But you start with a vision, and then it will develop probably into something else. You're right, I guess, you know.
Any comments to that? Huh?
Vision should be flexible. Once you get to the implementation stage, then you got to deal with issues, conflicts, SWOT analysis, for example, so that you can make the necessary adjustments. It needs to be flexible by the time you get to implementation.
I don't know if the vision needs to be flexible. Maybe the path is flexible. Is
yes.
that what you mean?
Probably.
Because if I want to develop low energy impact real estate products, commercial and residential, my vision is I want to do better energy consumption.
Right.
Yeah? Or that's my goal. One of my goals in a more sustainable development.
Okay.
And there are different ways to do this path.
Right.
The vision might not change. Maybe the extent to which I reach my vision. 100% versus 10%. Yeah.
I guess the it depends on how narrow and broad your vision might be. Because if your vision is like very narrow, it's like specific, like you want a blue building that's 6 stories high and this and that cannot be met. But if you have like a broad vision where it's like I just want to build in this location, then.
Well, let me ask you a very narrow question. In 10 years, your annual income, 1 million? Is that your vision?
1 million? Unless I'm losing money there. Yeah, 1 million should be.
I'm losing money.
I'm just making this up. 10 million.
10 million?
10 billion, man. Give me 10 billion.
All right.
Oh,
all
right. Nigerian diamond.
What else would you like to have in 10 years?
10 years from now?
Well,
it's more of how many properties I can put in place. So I want to have like probably control about $3 million square foot. I mean 3 million square footage of the property.
Mm-hmm. What about kids, family?
Kids and family.
What about the boat? What about the golf? See, I'm just trying to widen your vision of what could be in 10 years.
A possibility.
Yeah, like widen your horizon. So again, in the planning we were talking, a livable city. What does that mean? And then you have actually a series of workshops, brainstorming, charrettes, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And where you actually try to figure out where people want to be with their community, not particularly the personal goal, but the personal goals feed into that. Like we did in the Treasure Valley in Idaho, we did a metropolitan planning organization there. They did a communities in motion process for transportation planning. And then 7 or 8 workshops, if I remember right, and with 20 to 40 people sitting together in small groups and thinking about where people will live, where people will get moved, realizing in 30 years, the whole area is gridlocked. It's like here, Russia, huh? Because of not planning in a sustainable way, not putting the right vision in place before. Huh? The reason why I push this button here with vision is you gotta have an idea, a concept, a vision of what you want to dream about in the into the future, professionally and personally. You can rationalize that down to the comma point of 10 million and 12 cents annual income. If you only make 10 million, you didn't reach that goal. Now you feel that constraint. Think about that. Next time you walk through a neighborhood, your apartment complex or the backyard of your own house. Backyard of the old house is interesting. Who has a backyard? Are you guys planting flowers or any plants? Climate might not allow it. But you have an idea about how your backyard should look like in a year or two.
I plan it already.
Yeah? You even end up with a sketch where you want to plant that tree, that flower bed. You know? That's part of, I want to have a better neighborhood or better, make my backyard in a better look. I want to make this place home. Huh? Felt value. Home sweet home. So that vision. Maybe someone has the vision of home ownership at some time. Well, let's quote Spider-Man. With lots of powers come lots of responsibilities. So if you're a homeowner, you have responsibilities. Yes, please.
Yeah, I live in downtown Miami and a mayor. A mayor from about 10, 15 years ago, who was a very strong leader, had a vision of what Miami should look like, and he completely changed the building code and the zoning map and all of that, and called it Miami 21, and that's why we have a whole bunch of high-rise buildings now in Miami that looks like Manhattan, and it has completely increased the tax base. Like tremendously because of the density of the population and all of that. So not only did he achieve from that vision of a downtown Miami full of high-rise building, but economically it was quite an engine.
Good insertion, because the next slide is actually about beautiful cities. Garden City. Objectives and visions. Increasing the tax base versus, in this case, just about 1900. Ebenezer Howard, the Garden Cities, arguing that the town is really gross and filthy. Countryside is really great, but we need to create something in between. This is the time where sanitation was an issue, where people was overcrowded and really, really, really basically abused by landlords, slumlords, etc. Yeah? And the idea was basically creating something new, called the Garden City. This is a public accountant drawing up a land use plan, separation of land uses in 1902. Land use planning, as we heard maybe in the land use regulations, Euclidean zoning, the separation of land uses by a parcel, was decided by the US Supreme Court in 1926. So 25 something years before we have a Supreme Court case here, in the UK, this guy creates a central garden. Facets here is a central park. Grand Avenue is a major transportation circle. Yeah, integrates railroad and different manufacturing, engineering, cycle works. Yeah, separation of where you live and where you work. Different colors gives you a little bit of highlight here. Again, open space, farmland, different residential uses, yeah? It's a resident-owned concept. Pay rent on your land, but you actually have like share, like the Green Bay Packers fans. Mm. They all own the club, yeah? So, land must depend upon site selected. This is the vision, how to create a better place than a place called London. This is the time of what we call the great cities, London, New York, Paris. Yeah? And also the time when we try to destroy them, to rebuild them, to not to mistake our mistakes, redo our mistakes. central city here with 58,000, and then here the garden cities around it, connected with transit and roads. Unbelievable concept, written in a small piece of paper. Yeah, goes further, build it here and here. This is Greater London, completely swallowed in now. Yeah? But also, concept here, Redburn, New Jersey, was the idea of let's make it more livable, all the little dots are houses and green space. Yeah? You have here a highway and walkability, cul-de-sac, not because of the traffic pattern, but as a part of the safety ideas, kids can play there. Yeah? Nobody's running the kid over there, hopefully. But also interconnectivity into a park system. We see this now in developments. That park would be a golf course. Huh? Something like that. Or water bodies. If you look at Fort Lauderdale area, Google Earth, zoom in and zoom out, look at these palm plantation, pembroke pines. That's kind of a pattern. Huh? I'm new, so I interact with patterns. I find my way around because I recognize patterns. Same thing here, this is the conception of a neighborhood structure, Clarence Perry's diagram of the neighborhood unit. Again, if you remember the very first diagram we had, places of worship and gathering, in this case a church and some community support, church, some community structures, parks. This is something planners dream about. Oh, this is so great, this is walkable. When I got my ID just earlier this week, I was in the Student Union Center. They didn't have the ID print shop. They moved it. And they showed me a map. And I was like, hey, how far is that? I'm like, oh, it's not that far. New Hortz building. And they're like, where did you park? And I got behind the business school. Here. And I'm like, well, you walk this way, get your car, and come there. And I'm like, no, I walk this way. I completely confused the two students at the counter. Because I said, I walked this half a mile, a quarter mile in the heat outside to get my ID card and walk back to save extra time. Completely different concept, perception. I cannot develop walkable neighborhoods when walkable neighborhoods are not considered as part of the culture. The whole idea about condominiums and valet parking. Here's my car. I'm going inside. No. Park your car and you walk that 100 feet. Or 200. Speaking of cultural shocks, I have a friend, long-term friend, we're actually exploring the neighborhood. She used to work at FAU as a professor. She's literally in the message, this is valet parking, don't be scared. Knowing different cultures, you know? Mm-hmm.
But you know that's a culture.
Pardon?
I was just laughing. I said, yeah, they just hop in behind the wheel. I can see how that can be a little startling if you're not familiar.
New concept. Absolutely new concept. This is actually funny. This is actually from a publication from Michael Quinslan in 1974. But it looks like Futurama. Mm. I still need to figure out if Futurama is actually that old. That's actually like flying in, and this is where the sign would be where they crash. But the idea basically is future cities, dreams, envisioning. Any idea what that could be? About 50 years old. Anyone in here with an architectural background?
Where's Rebecca?
Architecture versus site plan, landscape. Okay, this is the city of Chandigarh. Designed by a guy called Le Corbusier, French Swiss architect. Very interesting art guy, Le Corbusier. More than happy to give you some more ideas via email. But he designed the city from scratch. So this is just a little bit of piece here, and then these are segments. This is actually an administrative center in the Punjab region in India. That's actually built. Versus the ideas. That's not supposed to be. Can you see that? contrast wise? Well, that's Manhattan Island, and that's Le Corbusier, the contemporary city. This is his attempt to rebuild Paris. Yeah? The very skyscrapers, like the crosses. Did a lot of drawings around that. Yeah? Speaking about the plan, this guy envisioned whole cities, yeah? Not just one apartment. And built even a model here, that's downtown Paris. Yeah? The island where the Eiffel Tower is standing. And completely rebuilt that. The catch is, they didn't do it there. They did a similar concept here. It's one of the so-called banlieues in the US. To give you the US context, as you mentioned that earlier, we would call that the projects.
Projects.
So that's the picture of the US on the bottom?
No, that's French.
Oh, okay. Well, this one, sure.
very loosely used, but this is to give you the idea. In 2004-2005, winter, I think early 2005, the French police chased an Algerian kid in the neighborhood. Kid hid in an electric substation, get electrocuted. Racial profiling, African immigrants there, Algerian immigrants. And huge tension of not registering and not recognizing culture and identity in a country where immigration is valuable to your society. Mm-hmm. Let me phrase it like this. Yeah? This caused from a neighborhood, this is not the, I'm not sure if this is the picture, Bonnier 13, 13 is the, I think the neighborhood 13 or project 13 is the area. This caused riots in the neighborhood, riots in Paris, riots across France, the state of emergency in France. Not just for a day. Yeah? Like serious, serious stuff going down. Let's phrase it like this in a politically incorrect political science language. The form we planned and built and put people in defines how we feel about our environment. The social economic status, SES, yeah, feeds into the so-called determinants of health. If you live in a poor neighborhood with a high crime rate, and you can't walk across the street two blocks and turn every corner five times because someone might follow you, and you have four deadbolts at your apartment door, versus you click your garage opener, you roll into your garage, and you wave hello to your neighbor a few hundred yards down the road. Those two extremes will deliver you different determinants of health, let's say stress and happiness. This delivers different scenarios for quality of life and puts a different vision into reality, vice versa, reality into vision. You know, might have been the highest, best use for the development, but somewhat not really implementing what was important. People.
And it impacts social values and behavior as well.
And over time, the impact escalated. Really great planning example of how we need to be aware of the different contexts and dimensions. That's what Lynch just says in the two first chapters. Yeah? As a socially aware planner, horrifying story. As a developer, let's make this polarizing here. Yeah, we built it. Person living there. Was it part of the plan 10 years later? Don't know. Yeah, I try to polarize here a little bit. Not to downsize here. Like, everyone's like, oh, man. It's just a bad guy. All right. Finalize this and then we start playing with those Legos. You have seen this before. Mexico? Yeah? City plan of a city of worship and ideas of spiritual context. This is... Talinjaya, Putrajaya. This is about Putrajaya. This is about 40 miles southeast of Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. Used to be a plantation. This whole thing is constructed from scratch. This is the new administrative center of Malaysia. Yeah? You can see, like in France, Champs-Élysées, Paris, or here, very long axis, we have the president's home, we have the prime minister's home, we have a large mosque. Large mosque here. And to give you an idea, that's the large mosque, that's a human being 6 foot. Think about that scale again. No? Think about that scale. That's actually that's me. That's the president's prime minister's palace. Yeah? Different perception. And that is this down here. From here down here. Perception. Yeah? Completely planned administrative office buildings. They literally put all this in place. All these are under construction. And that was in 2003 when we actually did the field trip. Instead of cruise, we actually flew out there and did that. So, got to get outside of your box to learn what's going on. And one of the first buildings erected was, I think, if I remember right, the mosque, spiritual sector. And then we put it in the power scheme to place. Yeah? Skip that. We all know this one. What's that?
New York Central Park.
Central Park. Does it say actually? Yes, that's it. Bonus points for reading. No? Famous map. Famous plaque. No? You ever walked it? That's a hell of a walk. No? All right. So we talk about city is beautiful movement. No? Garden City, creating more livable communities. This is London, workers' homes. Part of the movements back then, also with the city of Nuremberg, Siemens as an industrial company, was creating ownership among their workers. So you basically could buy a home here, work for the company, and work again, work for rent, work for low, for your mortgage, basically. Some of that idea. But also it's highly manufactured, you know, bang, townhouse right next to each other. But it provided an own home rather than rent and uncertainty. You know? This is 2003, south of Kuala Lumpur. That's a private city. Former copper mining, taking from a picture, Suntec City, taking a picture from a hotel, and back is actually an amusement park. The old dick, they put actually a wave pool in it, a light rail, a casino, and a college, private college. But this is just a section of a private city of about 80,000 people in 2003. Planning and real estate development in a completely different approach. The scale to put 80 to 100,000 people into a place as a private development, as its own city, in 2003. We're not talking about an apartment building with 800 units here. We're talking different dimensions. You know? So that's one of the thoughts. All right, last few slides about plans. So summing up chapter 2 basically. Functional and adequate to the function. That's one of the things we need to consider. Optimum communication. We have in the setup here five stakeholders. You will experience over the next few sessions and outside of classrooms meetings, you'll experience the challenge and the blessing of communication. Then the choice, I summarize this very quickly. Choice, what kind of product you do, what kind of development you do, the timing of your development. Cost, and this is why this book is so charming. It's so, on one side, into philosophy of places and spaces. And the next moment is very in-depth articulating what kind of costs we need to face and how we need to deal with them. And our gaming section actually is part of this because this is not making a nice looking plan? Does it actually rendering its cost and its feasibility? Does it make sense on your spreadsheet? And then later on in the sessions, we will talk about health and comfort, is it adaptable, and image quality. Quality of life. Is that a place you want to live or not? Is the building healthy for you? Mold, asbestos, lead paint, if you talk about old stuff. Again, this is second chapter. We're going to dig into that a little bit more next week as our opening. When we talk about the spirit of the site, I think I stressed that enough. If you have the chance, walk your development site. Walk it. Doesn't matter how big it is. Take that day. Depends. We have seen developments in Utah with 10, 12,000 single family homes. That's a walk. Then subsurface conditions, surface characteristics, landscaping, climate and acoustics. That's very interesting. Acoustics in a book from the 60s. Why is acoustics important now? Because the closer you are to the main road, you might have white noise or traffic noise. You might want to allocate your building, your residential units in a different way and form different acoustic patterns. Some college campuses have actually buildings arranged, I don't know about this one, have buildings arranged in such a way that they're actually dead spots, where you actually stand on top of a marker and it's absolutely silent. Like in a radio shop room, when you're like in a radio station, silent. Just because someone had the right experience and the feeling on setting these acoustics and arrangements in place.
But there are adaptations now with transportation facilities or building noise walls now.
Yeah. Famous example, German Autobahn. Bzzz. Looks like the LA River Channel. Big walls on the left and right with ripples to absorb the noise. Again, aesthetics, image, function. Do you need that noise reduction wall? Or could you change traffic pattern around this? Versus, do you need to have a four-floor apartment building right next to the interstate? And then build that noise reduction in there? Or is vegetation over years better? Good question. Big bang for the buck. Put the concrete wall in place. Because it's functioning the next day, not in 10 years with the trees and vegetation. Does it clean the air? Does it clean the soil? Does it retain water? We'll see. And then man-made characteristics. When I read this, my first thought is brownfields, leftover damages of prior constructions. Also, the interesting concept is that depends again on the state and laws. Do you actually plan to deconstruct? That means if you build a home, do you actually have the architectural plans to deconstruct it all? What are the costs and the energy used to get rid of it or to transform it? Big governmental projects like the Olympic Games have been scrutinized by that and criticized by that. I think if I remember right, the Olympic Games in Sydney, every stadium newly built had to have a redevelopment plan, including total deconstruction. Otherwise, they didn't approve it. So what you had before like this, they changed it to this. They changed the seating to make it more livable in there, or added other kind of seatings to it in the stadiums. Change the purpose and the function, repurpose those single event buildings. Huge criticism in the past and in the future still. But lastly, process and program. Unsystematic approach and a systematic approach. And I want to keep it with this type two quotes. The image of the site guides the design. Well, we have to figure out what he means with the image of the site. Versus the given the site, what is its best use? bulldoze it down and put a parking lot on it instead of $1 million investment. Might be the best HPU. Yeah? So the goal is in the next few sessions to tease you with the idea of think about this, think different. There is no pure linear 101 to do things. I think the charm of good design and good development is because a real estate developer, in conjunction with communication with all involved parties, put some personal touch onto it. You can see it with just the way the signage is done. You can see that with street layouts, if there is actually some reconsideration about traffic patterns and parking. Do I need all the time the amount of parking written into the code? Or can I do a daytime or use-based parking allotment? When I say, hey, I have a parking range, not a total amount. My best example is the German EPA. They have, if I remember right, 5 fixed parking spots, but they would need hundreds. But their office is outside of Berlin and they commute. They basically have visitor parking and one parking spot for the president's car, which used to be a Volkswagen Golf. I had classes with them, so you told us the fun stories all about that. Good. Think about that. Site planning is using the site as its whole, not just from one angle, not one perspective. All possible perspectives with limitations, because you can't do everything the right way. Try to maximize its use, therefore your profits coming out of that. You might, because you communicate well with all involved parties, you might have to deal with not 100% of profit, maybe 99% of profit, because you follow the rules and the interests of the others. Yeah? Could be 98%. Well, we'll see. Comprehensive approach in a holistic view, narrowing it down at the end to the site, to the building. The example for us here in the class will be different if you use a different setup. You do Elmridge neighborhood versus in Yorktown. That is a northeast city versus a southern city. It would be different in the way community thinks about development. Huh? Right, I think that was everything today. Let's play. Let's get you started on the other stuff. Urban plan. Who had time to look at it? So we might have digged into it already or not. Some of you might have been surprised that you're actually using it, and some of you are very, very excited about it. As we heard from Kyle, he loves to play Lego. You know?
Nice, Kyle.
It's actually Duplo, not Lego, but it's all
the same, man.
Urban plan. Urban plan is about a neighborhood called Elmwood District in the city of Yorktown. Like many urban communities throughout the country, the Elmwood District, once a thriving part of town, has deteriorated. Residential and business tenants have moved away from the area, leaving vacant lots and some vacant or underused buildings. So once upon a time, there was a small town, you know? The city of Yorktown is seeking a private real estate development team, you, to propose and build a project that will revitalize the once proud neighborhood one sprawled neighborhood. That is a buzzword for
neighborhood
failed value and identity. Of Yellow District. Yorktown has sent your company a request for proposals detailing the city's goals and objectives for the neighborhood and inviting you to compete with this development project. And the way we do this competition is we split the group in two. We have 13 registered students, so we're going to have 6 and 7. Yeah. The team setup is for 5 minimum, 5 to 7. That will work. We have more experienced and somewhat not so experienced folks in this class with the development processes. Yeah? Like Alex is a little bit more experienced based on his amount of classes versus Kristen. Mm-hmm. Yeah? So there's some newbie factor. Oh, where you can't say, hey, yeah, this is like we did it in finance, in financing class. I gotta build this different experience levels. Before addressing the complex issue involved in this project, it would be helpful for you to consider some general development questions and concerns in light of your personal values. That's what we're going to do. Before we even start this, I think I gave you my original two. Where's the
paper thing?
Did everyone get papers?
Yes.
No, I don't need this. What are we going to do? For about 10 minutes, faster than if we are, we're going to take the exercise number 2. That's one sheet I gave you guys. Exercise 2, personal priorities investigation. Remember, we talked for the last 4 hours or more. We talked about planning, how planning transforms sites. But I always came back to quality of life and the persons. People make places. So trade-offs. Every decision comes with a cost. Each decision to use a resource requires a trade-off. CBA. With another possible use for a resource. The money you have in your wallet, for example. Again, French fries and potato chips. You only, if you like, don't like French fries, you're not buying French fries. Example on the side. In designing your development, you will confront some difficult decisions to make trade-offs. And if you keep reading this, you will know for the next 10 minutes, find your spirit, find your vision, set your priorities. Looking at those priorities and questions and rank them. And we have a discussion how that fits together. Okay? Right, good. Think on paper.
Okay.
this is for discussion only.
Oh.
What would be good for this, we pass them and I put them in an Excel spreadsheet later and see who's, how the group decided on the development terms. We could do that. That's one that you could do. Do not write your name on these.
Okay.
Or your ID, I don't care. This is for getting your ideas straightened out, like questions about boundaries and to which extent you will sacrifice a social component versus an economic component. But since there are ranking numbers, that could be actually a really good exercise to restart next week. Give me those, I put them into an Excel spreadsheet and you can see the scoring, where it went down or not. Everyone done?
Yeah, we're done.
Get done. We kept talking to Ron about the syllabus today. All right. If you had to decide today, which would you say is more important for development to emphasize? Shops or housing?
Jobs.
I'm sorry.
Like employment.
Jobs, I got you.
You know that there are chops, there are chops, and there are chaps. It's too early to talk about chops as being a little bit oregano, olive oil, lamb chops. We're talking about jobs that pay for the lamb chops.
There we go, I'm with you.
German like accent. That. There might be some funny things coming up after 5 hours talking. Go ahead, Alex.
Okay, well, obviously it varies everywhere, you know, but I'm saying specifically for South Florida, I would say from what I've been coming across, and especially with like we go to these different conferences, economic forums, and different things, learning about the trends in our area, they're saying that people, particularly millennials, are now looking for where they want to live before they search for a job. So people are more and more basing where they're living just on the area itself rather than employment. So I think focus on awesome housing and a lifestyle, and you know, cultivating that lifestyle, and then the jobs will just come. They'll commute. You know, they'll choose a place to live first, though.
Buzzwords: footloose economy and creative class. Richard Floyd, I wrote a book about that. Yeah, Boise, Idaho is one of those places. I have a bunch of friends who had no job, moved through the city, just did hang out for a while, worked here and there, smaller jobs, and then because they're in IT or other newer footloose sectors, banking, programming, got a job, moved to Seattle a year, 2 years later because that was the next step. Good point. So we're not anymore relocation bound with that. Would you more develop jobs or housing on a site then?
Oh, well, I would deal with housing then, but like for example in like Michigan where all the car plants and stuff were, people aren't like really moving there. The people that are there now need more jobs, so then I would look into creating jobs. It really depends on where I am, what the economic forces are.
All right. Comments?
I would actually go with job development. So I like that. It can improve the economic development of the area because I feel that jobs tend to bring people into the area, and then the housing can come afterwards because people might want to accommodate to that area and probably work, live, and play there as home. So.
All right. Other comments, Stephen?
That kind of ties into three, but you know, my understanding of the current marketplace, the demand is very strong for more affordable workforce housing, and you know, young professionals are struggling to come up with down payments to afford these homes. So if you're providing, you know, single family or townhomes at an affordable rate, I mean, that's where it's at right now.
Whatever affordable rate means in the regional context, yeah, could be $50,000, could be $200,000 homes. Yeah. Any other comments about this?
Yeah, I'd go with commercial for a couple of reasons. One, the gig economy is picking up, and also the employment figures are going down. And in fact, what I'm saying, employment is improving. So those two issues coupled together would suggest that we need to provide more opportunities to stimulate that part of the economy and bring about some improvement in the economy, and then start to follow the residential component to meet the needs of people providing quality of life, walkability, and those kinds of things.
Let me ask you a question. Is it the job of a real estate developer to develop the local economy or not?
Well, they play a part. They play a part in that process.
Wow.
In this scenario,
this scenario for that setting, yeah, because it's a task you have been asked to do that. Huh? Nobody asked commercial development. What type of commercial development? Did anyone question the type of commercial development?
Appropriate to the market.
All right. So could be office, could be medical.
Right.
Yeah. Could be more because we have to drill down to the RFP. That's kind of homework for this week.
Could you really do medical if you don't have any housing there? Because people want to live close to, you don't
want to... Well, medical means a lot. Could be a dentist.
Yeah, but even then, I mean...
Oh, housing.
Yeah, because if
there's
no housing...
Yeah, but it's the medical facility, right?
The setup, hey, there's a fine line right now. This is taking from the beginning. Plan. So you actually need. This is kind of the setup. It's the map. Yeah. So.
Oh, so we're not talking like.
Well, that's the reason I say the fine line. There's a fine line. There's one thing we envision, and one thing is coming from. This is actually part of an exercise that feeds into this. So in this context, there's housing and existing offices and other uses around. Yeah, and the fundamental idea, queen space, what would you build between those two uses? A highly specialized dental practice needs its support. Yeah, typical thing with regional economic indicators, you gotta have some multipliers and gotta have a critical mass of people using that. A National Football League football team needs a strong area of fans to actually support the games at the stadium. That's the other example. So you could say the mix of commercial is important in the discussion. I think also you can't go one or the other purely.
Right.
The way I read answers between you guys was she is a little bit more on housing. You're definitely more on the commercial side, more on the chops. Yeah? The balance is the question. To which extent do you do that? Yeah? Do you generate jobs with your development, or you just put housing in place because there are other jobs in that area already present, or not? And if it's not, then you're right. Why would you develop that? Yeah? Next question. Parks or parking? Why?
Parks.
I would say parks. I did not go for parking because I think the trends are showing like we have Uber and all this stuff that probably people are more willing to maybe not even drive. Even the new cars are coming out like self-driving or something like that. I don't know. So at one point, I think that would be maybe routes that, have buses and stuff like that. And so I would not use parking though. I think I would go for parks. We have a need for more green spaces.
Any other comments about that?
Yeah, I go with parks because I think we understand that parks will provide a lot of green space, deals with climate change issues, provide opportunities for walkability, exercise, health and welfare, and also, just like she said, less and less people are owning cars and driving now, so parking is not becoming a real big need anymore. We need to ratchet down parking and provide for some of these other quality of life issues.
Emmanuel, what's your take? Parks or parking?
Parking.
You know, it's funny, first I said parking, and then I was thinking about the trends, and I don't really have an option. I wouldn't do parks, but you have to pick, so I would go with parks.
I see being able to charge a huge premium for my green building and my lead designated whatever with more parks, so I'm actually making more money by creating more green space.
Right. Even for the building code tells you have to have X amount of parking.
Well, yeah, I try to do the minimum if I have to.
All right, min-max. min-max, again, objectives. solve the objective function, French fries versus potato chips, parks versus parking. Anything else, parks and parking? This is a hot issue apparently. Everyone, come on, one, two, three.
Just the first one.
Wait, let them finish first.
I think that it really depends on how dense the area is. If you're located in a downtown, you're going to need more parking, depending on the type of structure that it really is. If you're in an area where it's not really like a downtown type of area, then you might need more green space, or vice versa. In this case, it all depends what type of culture there is there, whether there are children, whether there are animals over there. Some complexes, they don't accommodate to them. In that case, they may need parks, because in those complexes, they may not have that for them.
Yeah.
You know, I'm big on big green space and everything, but it's just parking. Just because I know a lot of current developments have a lot of parking issues, and the municipalities are fighting them on that. There's been a lot of retail centers too that I've been to, like the shops at Pembroke Gardens, for example. You try going there on a Saturday evening, you can't find parking. You know, it makes experience horrible. You know.
But you know that I wanted to tell you that later. You know what that means. Technology has changed. Now you actually are talking about to implement a transit option called Uber into our plan. I wrote that actually down. Promote alternative transport options, reduce parking. Yeah?
Yeah.
So if Uber is now a service company, no. It's just choice cab companies in one way, but it is a dynamic transit option, individual dynamic transit option.
Yep.
And it's beside. Yeah.
Sometimes
how this transforms urban space into action.
And now they're doing even like shuttle. They don't even like going just, their new route. So they are just expanding. That alternative is there. So.
And when you wait, it's even cheaper than paying for parking.
Yeah.
I mean, if you take Uber or Lyft.
It's cheaper. If you have the time, it's cheaper than getting a rental car.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah? If money is the issue, not time. You had a question.
Yeah, I was kind of curious about getting this. Why parking versus parks? Or is it just something else in between?
Soil, grass, and permeable grounds
and
versus non-permeable asphalt or blacktop runoff. That's usually the idea between quality of life. Parks in the size of the Central Park in New York are considered urban lungs. Yeah? They present clean air circulation and particular air flow. There's also a reason why you used to have in some classic urban design that you actually have like a green belt or like almost radial structures coming out as flow air in and out. Yeah? Remember the pictures I showed you? Green space, the interstate connector? That's like a promenade thing. Like a park and then two lanes park, two lanes in and out. Yeah. Transports air, urban climate, huge problem nowadays, air quality nowadays. So parks serving not just walk around time, it's not serving just walk the dog and take sleep underneath a nice tree, it's also air quality. Yeah. So a huge discussion in terms of development is, are you promoting the proper green space? Therefore you have certain environmental factors, natural resources, versus the function of parking with all the negative impacts.
I guess
stormwater, etc.
I guess the question is, parking you can generate money. Parks you kind of offset money to taxpayers' money. Is there like a middle ground, like the farming, like urban farming? You get taxpayers' money to get the land, and then you sell the crops.
Could be that some cities do that, urban farming, and saying, okay, if this is a vacant property, while it's vacant and not developed, let the neighborhood farm on it.
Right.
Then you have the problem that you officially can't resell the produce, because that's a violation, that will be commercial use, that's a violation of the local ordinance. City of Cincinnati had those problems, but they solved it somewhere. You could trade, the food,
right.
But you couldn't say, hey, give me a dollar or two. but that's a different approach. The fundamental question here is, first of all, parking does not necessarily produce revenue. If I don't charge for the parking lot has no direct revenue.
How we charge?
Yeah?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Like you don't, here, in front of,
yeah.
In front of,
just be parking,
in front of Whole Foods, your consumer shopping at Whole Foods has no direct payment on its on the parking spot.
Well, Whole Foods pay for parking.
But they pay for parking in terms of development, somewhere, but not on a continuous way, unless they rent it out. Different cost structure. But coming from a planning perspective, arguing, hey, what do you want to see? Whole Foods parking lot, or, I don't know, 300 places, or would you like to see 200 places with some trees? That's kind of the dreamer, planner, make it nice and happy, versus only charge for it.
Plus climate change.
Huh? So yeah, let's just down road, globally speaking, the other way. Yeah? So yeah, you can price out everything. There's a number on the cost of life according to your life insurance. Yeah, you can price out everything. The fundamental question, this is then the idea of environmental economics, is the Amazon rainforest. Take it down to today's fine wood prices and price it out and say it's X billions of dollars worth in wood. Or what is the indirect, long-term, sustainable cost if you, let's say, include carbon trade, etc., and say every year that tree is healthy and standing there, global air system, etc., will benefit from it. Different cost models, huge political scene behind it. Yeah? So that tree in front of your house, are you going to cut it down for a parking lot? Or are you enjoying it because it gives shade, and it reduces your energy balance from your house because the shade is less heating up the roof and the AC is less consumed? Or are you just angry because you get, because of some seasonal appearances, you get leaves all the time on the top of your car?
Well, now you you are bringing up a huge planning question that's been going on for a while, because I mean, downtown Fort Lauderdale, Las Olas, like, they're trying to do what they did in New York. In New York, you could walk miles and not get tired, but here in Florida, you walk like 2 miles, you're already tired because they don't build the buildings next to each other. Like, you have a lot of trees and...
Different context. Huh? Lessons learned from today. You're like, bam, made a click, worked it out. Yeah? Different context. I grew up, personal experience, I grew up from the length of this building, my parents' home, past a 4 or 5 units apartment, a condominium house. It was in a mixed-use apartment development with the post office, a pharmacy, a barbershop and bakery. Now the barbershop bakery, they always changed. Yeah? So my Saturday morning was walking from my mom, my parents' kitchen through garage, getting fresh pretzels, literally out of the oven, fresh pretzels, put them on the bed at home, and have a cup of coffee. Here, I'm driving 20 minutes. Or I need to plan for it, that, hey, if I want to have fresh rolls tomorrow, I'm going to buy them tonight, and put them in, wake up half an hour early, to heat up the oven, and bake them. Yeah? Or I just microwave stuff. Different concept, different cultures, places.
Who's right?
Huh?
Who's right? Who's right?
Well, how do you feel about it?
That's a determination.
How do you feel about it? About this question? What was your answer? More parking or more parking?
I went with parking, but I mean, I went with parks because parking is going to be expensive.
How about you as an entrepreneur and developer, you really want to do all this parking, but your clients really want to see parks. How
yeah,
about that?
I never worked with
huh? All right, last question on this. A strong tax base so the city can provide services to its residents, or, this is more linked to the game setup, or affordable housing so middle and low income people can afford to live there. Why? Stephen, you started affordable housing. So
sure.
Go ahead.
As I mentioned, demand's high. Young professionals spend more than if I'm not mistaken, 40% of your annual income just on rent, because they can't afford down payments on homes. You know, kind of the same situation myself, so I can relate to that, and I feel it's a good opportunity right now, a snapshot as of today, to go ahead and provide an affordable product.
All right, anyone else?
I agree with him 100%.
Okay.
I agree with him 100%.
You can't tax people if they can't afford, it doesn't matter if you raise their taxes, if they can't afford the rent to begin with or the housing there, then they're not going to live there. So you're not going to get that tax income regardless.
Or if they can't afford a mortgage.
Yeah.
Anymore.
I just would choose affordable housing because I wouldn't trust the government to disperse the money to the proper people. They may need it, and I'm thinking if you develop affordable housing as something tangible, we'll know that it's being used.
All right, Alex?
Just South Florida is full of resort communities, downtown Fort Lauderdale, Miami, Palm Beach, and downtown West Palm, they're within walking distance. Somebody has to serve these resorts and stuff, and you usually, you know, a lot of these service people, they don't even own cars. I live in a neighborhood, and I just see droves of people walking in their work uniforms to work, so I would, this is just my personal experience. Is that they need to live within walking distance, quite simply. And when there's no affordable housing, we don't have anybody to serve the resorts and the restaurants and, you know, et cetera.
All right.
So build low income compound to start to build
up.
That's not exactly what I meant. Like, these people walking in can't live in this place, so they got to go build them an affordable compound.
You don't know me at all, so maybe not, don't make an assumption about who I am as a person.
Don't make no assumption when you come to that either.
Keep it calm. housing can explode very easy.
Yeah.
See, East Side versus West Side.
I believe in a mixed-use type of development residentially where you've got a high end who can afford affluent accommodation, middle class, and affordable housing so you can satisfy all of the communities by creating a tax base. Because even the affordable housing, the reason why it is affordable is because there's some tax component to the development. So I think that you need to look at the big picture whereby you're incorporating all of the elements of residential development so that everybody benefits. It's a win-win-win situation.
So this is an interesting component, which I have that here too. Balanced.
Yeah.
Now, depending on the side, depending on the mission or vision, both cases, and we'll see this is our playground. Yeah. I think you can do some affordable, some high-end. Just because you do affordable housing doesn't mean that you can't build the penthouse right next to it or on top of it. The question is if your tenants and your buyers won't accept that mix. That's the other thing. Conceptually, now let's dream.
All right, that's what
we're doing. Dream.
Okay.
Conceptually, we can do this. Does it make sense in reality? Will it be accepted in reality? That's a different step. We can make those dreams up here. Gotta have that concept. If you never learned to dream, you will never dream. And if you never learned about his dream or her dream or his dream, you don't respect those opinions. Yeah? So let's play with this. And I said, okay, but focus on community character. You said resort towns, a lot of that. Yeah? Versus very blunt, straightforward, common. There's something more going on with just housing, affordable housing. That's something, a buzzword for everything next attached to it. Social economics, status, social economics, SES. The end determinants of health. Come back to that. Demographic, socioeconomic variables. Come back to that.
I like
there are certainly areas, let me finish, to put this on a really funny way. What is affordable housing? What are housing units in affordable housing? And that depends on the context. So stereotype, affordable housing in Aspen, ski resort town, might look different than here. In my own experience, I've seen places, Rehoboth Beach, Dewey Beach in Delaware, where the folks who cater and do the food commute an hour outside of these places. because they cannot afford the rent, but to rent in those beach communities. That's 10, 12 years ago. Yeah? So an old example, probably worsened already, unless the government or some entity, typically government in this case, local government, put something forward that increases that kind of mix of income and other socioeconomic factors. Yeah? So good. There are some tensions here in the room. It's going to be fun.
Yeah,
go ahead, priorities.
I'm good.
No.
What I've been noticing is that different like community revitalization administrations have been pumping money into like certain areas adjacent to the like the downtown Hudson stuff. So I guess that's part of the affordable housing initiative, right?
Well, I would consider this as a general idea of rehab. Or economic rehabilitation in any form. You can do economic development through office, new attractions, good housing, revamping housing stock, getting rid of blight and just cluttered communities. Clean up can help. There's this fantastic story we tell in planning classes that a bucket of paint will change a neighborhood. Because if you have somewhat tough homeowners or good tenants that would say, let's get $50 or $100 of paint together and paint this old house, just the facade, it will change the look, it will change the aesthetics, the design, the image. If you clean out the street, no more litter on the street, you have better curbside. Huh? Simple thing, I don't know where you guys live, how you deal with your trash collection. I live in a small single family neighborhood. I have two neighbors who keep their trash out for 3 days after it was collected. Mm-hmm. It's just sitting there. Because they're commuting all the time, they're traveling. But I'm pretty sure that if you don't know that, it's like, man, this guy's not taking care of their property. Mm-hmm. I had folks complaining about their neighbors because the neighbor doesn't cut the grass every 7 days, five times. Yeah? Because the grass was that high. Mine's going to be that high. It grows like wheat right now when I come home. Yeah? So, gotta put that in perspective. Our responsibilities on neighbors, they're called, if you're crazy in a homeowner association, they're calling the president of the homeowner association just because you put the trash out on Tuesday and not on Wednesday night like it's supposed to be. Well, good luck. I'm traveling. I'm not here on Wednesday. Well, then it's complain about the smell of the trash if you don't do it. So different cultures, different perspectives. You gotta put that in perspective. Setting priorities. Let's finish this up. The redevelop must include uses that consumers will demand and support financially. This is related to the setup of the game. You all read already, I know. Are you considering that as a priority or not?
Yes.
Yes? Yes. All right. We're going to put the rankings next together for next week. So common sense here is yes. That's true. Yes.
Yeah. 10.
Well, let's see next week.
8. I got it.
Redeveloper must be able to provide a reasonable profit to the developer, so that the developer can attract investors willing to risk the money in the project.
So I gave that 8.
I believe a lot of these questions, every developer is here to make money. But you will not work for free or just, it's hard because you want to worry about nature, but at the same time, you want to make money. So it's a very, so if you see it in this perspective, well,
yeah. You want a reputation too.
Yeah,
so
I know, but I'm saying it's hard. You have to balance it.
But let's make it an extreme case where we played numbers earlier. Is it a million or 10 million?
No, that one is the middle with money.
But I think like if the goal is to redevelop an area, there isn't going to be that much of a need for equity partners to come in and put up all the money, because there'll probably be incentives from the city and the government to try to subsidize the development plan, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there wouldn't be that such a focus in having like one person bringing $10 million. That's why I didn't put it as such an important thing.
Oh, come on.
How much do you think the government's going to contribute?
No, but if there's a plan to like revitalize an area, the government will give subsidies for
CRA.
So I'm just giving that into account.
I wrote my dissertation about mixed use development and the economic optimization of it, and to which extent the quality of life as the external part of the neighborhood should be influencing the revenues of the mixed use development.
So you should share that.
I'll publish it next week. So you gotta get some time to finish stuff. But the idea is 1 million or 10 million, well maybe let's say 10 million, but would you be okay to be more towards the community with 9.5 million?
I'll
take it.
Huh? Yeah.
And that is the kind of the social component that is actually here. No, wait. Land use planning is meeting real estate. Let's open up that bridge.
Yep.
That question leads basically to the fundamental discussion. Highest and best use, squeeze out every penny versus pain.